Hello, hello, everybody. It is 7:20 a.m. Central Time on the 19th of March, 2019. And we are here to talk about seismic events. We're looking at Earthquake 3D, and we're using the USGS along with the EMSC to give us a good view of what's going on. And for the new people here, I know there's always some new person in here. The earthquakes that are raised high off the globe are deeper down into the earth. So the higher they are off the globe, the further down into the core or through the mantle that we go. So I'm going to turn on a display capture so you'll be able to see my mouse a little bit better. And we're going to start here really quick in the West Pacific. Everything that's hit since last night. So this is the five that was over here next to Solomon Islands, north of New Caledonia last night. We're going to jump over here, and then you're going to see a spread of the same sized earthquakes. 4.8, 4.9, 4.9, 4.4, 4.7. The 4.4 being the smallest of the bunch, but it's about the same size. We're really dealing with 4.9, 4.9, 4.8, 4.7. And the spread of this goes from Western Java, Indonesia, all the way past up to the Izu Ridge in Japan. Then we're going to skip over all of Japan. And last night's 4.2, which is even smaller, of course. We are spanning out and spreading out. As we span out and spread out, we lose energy. So it goes from 4.4 down to 4.2 as we go further to the north. Now you'll see it's a giant open silent zone right now off the east coast of Japan, where we have an earthquake here and an earthquake here, like bookends. And in the middle point is where we watch for the larger accumulation to happen, the sandwich point between the two areas that are moving. Also, I'd like to point out Java, Indonesia hit by this 4.8 and this 4.9. Right in the middle here is Mount Agung, and Mount Bromo. Agung and Bromo both blowing yesterday with fairly significant size volcanic blast. This is Sakurajima on the screen right now. Looks pretty quiet right now. And that probably will change throughout the day. Let's go down the list of volcanoes that are erupting. See what's going on. Ibu over in Indonesia. Several times. Popocatépetl in Mexico. Planchon, Petaroa, Chile, Argentina border. Manam last night was a 30,000 foot high blast, or 33,000 foot high blast. Now it's 15,000 foot high blast, but we can add in Currency with a 15,000 foot high blast. Bromo up to 13,000 now. Popocatépetl, Ibu again, Bromo, Dukono, Sakurajima. Anybody else today so far? Wow, this list is kind of long. We have Bromo and Ebico also. Sabancaya, Uriventador, and that gets us into last night with Poas. Well, this is a big change. Over in the West Pacific in particular. Let's start over here where we have Mount Currency. Mount Currency in Sumatra, Indonesia, southeast Sumatra. Then next to it, Krakatau. Krakatau was last night, yesterday afternoon. Then we get to Bromo right here and Agung right here. And then we get over here and we have Ibu and Dukono. We get over here and we have Mount Manam. Let's count those off. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Seven volcanoes erupting just across Indonesia going into Papua New Guinea right here. Seven in just one day's, not even one day's time. Since my update last night at 10 p.m., it hasn't even been 12 hours. So we're talking a major amount of eruptive activity going on through here. And all we have to do is go back a few days and there were a series of deep earthquakes that hammered off on the underside of the plate. So the deep earthquakes, there's no doubt about it, there is a shallow upwelling effect that affects the surrounding areas, volcanically and seismically. So here's the real way you should look at it. Over the last 48 hours, look what's happened across the West Pacific. It's spread in three directions. One, over to the west. Another, going up to Taiwan. And the third, going up to the east and going up past Japan, over into Alaska. Now all that can be traced back to here, where we had our big deep earthquake activity. Aussies, oi, 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 here we go. Look at this, 2.9 to 3.0 coming in right in the middle of the edge of the craton. Look which way our arrow points coming in from the northwest. I've been waiting for this. Let's go take a look and see where exactly it is. Ah, well, you know, that's not an earthquake. Ah, this is an earthquake. Get some prawns on the barbie. I didn't get some coffee here. Hold on. Okay. Hey, you guys do American impersonations all the time, y'all. I hear the y'all stuff. You got your cowboy hat on, y'all. Let's turn on our locations. Check this out. Look where the earthquake is. And, oh, well, I'll be. There it is. Uluru, Ayers Rock. You guys know about this. It juts up out of the Australian landscape. You've seen it probably in a bunch of Australian movies. And there it is. So when I told you to watch a few days back, where did we tell you? We told you to watch on the edge of the center of the craton, next to Uluru, Ayers Rock. All right, look at my choices here. We could have chosen anywhere on the entire plate. Why did I choose the spot next to Ayers Rock? Let's show you. Why did I choose? Well, we can just turn on our other quakes. Ah, look at this. So this one's a 2.9 to 3.0 today here, but we have previous 4.7 and even a 6.1. Now, the reason the earthquakes are striking here is the same reason there's a jutting up rock feature out of the edge of the plate, not just at Uluru. Here, Ulura, whatever it's called. There's other formations that are just like it that most people don't even really know about. Everybody knows about this one because it's kind of more out in the field. Out in the fields, or the, what do they call that? The outback? All right, well, it's out there in this open area, and this is more of a little bit mountainous, but it's the same type of feature. Jutting up features pushed up out of the center of the plate. Now, look up to the north. See these? Where have we seen a shape like this before? Has anybody seen anything like this? What if I told you it looked like the United States? What if I told you it looked like Iran? What if I told you that there were spots all around the world that looked just like this? Let me show it to you. Over in the United States, prove my case. Turn off our quakes, places, volcanoes. Here we are. Well, look at where we are. We're in Arkansas, but it's covered in trees, as opposed to down in Australia. Let's turn off our borders and labels. There we go. Now you'll start to see it. See? Bends and folds in the edge center portion of the craton. Now here in the Midwest U.S. and look over here on the east coast of the United States. Same thing. Bends and folds in the edges of the plates. Now scientists incorrectly assumed, and they assumed this, that this was formed by glaciers. Here, let's go over and show you over in Iran, where there certainly weren't any big glaciers coming down to here. All these folds and bends in the edge of the plate here, over at Afghanistan, South Pakistan, and Iran, are just like what we were just looking at over in Australia. Now these are on the outside edges, but again, in the middle of the edge of the plate. Right? There, let me show you another spot. Myanmar, but it's covered in trees. Same type of structures. All right, now you get the picture. Interior portion of the plate, the bends and folds and buckles in the plate. You can also see it up here in China. We have the same kind of thing, but it's much bigger, of course, going on there. So now we can jump all the way back here to Australia and take a look one more time. See? So, bends and folds in the edge of the plate, alongside of it, jutting up rock features that come up out of the earth, and then our earthquakes strike next to these spots. That's not a coincidence. It's something we told you to watch for. I know it's just a three, but I had to explain it because, man, we told you to watch for it. There it is. Okay, now we're going to jump over China and Russia. Well, before I jump over Russia, the Caspian Sea was struck by a 4.0, but mainland Russia and China, no earthquakes again reported today. Now, I mean, come on. Even the biggest skeptic who doesn't even like me at all and probably has a problem with everything I say, even your eyebrows got to be raised at this point. Do you think whole continents go quiet for weeks on end? Come on. Nobody's reporting earthquakes out of those areas. Now, you can get into why. I don't want to hear technical explanation, you know, excuse. Oh, it must be some kind of technical outage. Yeah, no, look here. Top of the list right here, NNC, Kazakhstani agency. We trust them to report the earthquakes out of Kazakhstan. Of course, I'm going to trust them to report right next to Kazakhstan. And look, a 4.9. A 4.9 out next to Kazakhstan, and Russia. USGS and EMSC ignoring the earthquakes. How many more do I need to show you? But I'm going to show you this location, just so there's no debate. When you'll see where it is. Look where it is. See this? This giant oval shape where there's a crescent-shaped lake down here to the south? Here, let me turn off all the borders and labels. Crescent-shaped lake down here and a bend like this to the south? Look, corresponding up to the north, it's the same thing. Only this is risen and this is sunken. It's sunken, it's filled with water to the south, and it's risen up to the north, making mountain ranges. In the middle, it bulges. And you can see that defining edge at least on this side. And if you look down close on this side, there's a river that goes and kind of borders on the eastern side of here. Now this ultimately goes all the way over to the east across most of Siberia. And this, I'm tracing the outline edge of it, is an interior portion of the craton. And well, I'll be. We're on the outside edge of the interior portion of the craton in Russia. I mean, come on. So Siberia, Russia, 4.9 earthquake. Here's southwestern Siberia, Russia. Is this a small quake or a normal sized quake? Here, four. Another four. 4.9 and 4.0 just in the past few hours. Western agencies show you nothing. Here's where the other earthquake is. 4.0. I'll be. It's right on the edge of this giant oval dome shape. Not my take on it. There it is. That's where the 4.0 is. I just gave you two examples. Do I need to give you more? But I think I'm proving my case. Southwestern Siberia, northwestern Siberia. Here's Xinjiang, China. Let's go see. Another four, or you could say a 3.6 to 4.0. I wouldn't fault the Western agencies for not having threes, okay? I really wouldn't. So we'll skip over that one, and we'll go find another one in China. Oh, look, another one in Russia. A 5.1 in Russia. Dang, all right. Well, I'm glad I'm checking. We have an outbreak going on in Russia today, compared to where we were yesterday, which was jack squat. There we are. Now we're back to the other spot where the 4.9 happened. Different times, different quakes. Got a swarm going on here. Fours and fives. I just proved it, guys. I just proved it to you. I don't think I need to even go any further than to show you. Fours and fives are striking out across China and Russia. And what does the Western agency show us? Dun-dun-ba-dun. Play the Price is Right losing horn. Someone. Let's go over to the USGS website and just go make sure. You know, I don't want you to think that I'm just using USGS feed and they're, you know, could be coming from their website or something. See? Whole continents missing earthquakes for weeks on end. We have to twist the arms of the agency. I have to complain like this, and then they'll report an earthquake. So why does it matter if fours and fives are striking across China and Russia? Well, yesterday I showed you upper fours striking right here at the Taklimakan Desert. Now across Siberia. This is all going to add up and go to the west. It's going to go over into Iran, then over into Europe. It's already heading over into Iran. The Caspian Sea has been hit. You can take this over to the west, and it's a line of twos and threes that goes across all of Europe. But look who got hit today. Next to Sardinia, just west, southwest of Florence. I think that's Sardinia. Hold on. I'm guessing here. Corsica. Oh, man, there's going to be a bunch of people who are pissed. Bunch of Corsicans who are going to be pissed at good old Dutch for calling them Sardinian. Oh, here, let's go take a look. Sorry, guys. It's still early in the morning for me. Let's turn on our borders and labels. There it is. Here's Sardinia. Here's Corsica. What's the difference? Well, to them, a lot. To me, I'm from a world away. It's two islands right next to each other. There's a 3.3. Now, we're looking for something to come in here up on the plate boundary, and this is no laughing matter. We're actually looking for 4.0 and greater activity to spread out across Italy, Croatia into Bosnia, and over east into Romania. So far, we've only seen threes. That's good. The swarm up at the Swiss-Italy border is still carrying on the plate boundary, and the three from last night is still visible over at the Canary Islands. Up to the far west by northwest from all this, we go up to Svalbard. Svalbard. There it is, 2.9, up here in the middle of nowhere at the North Arctic Circle, northeast of Greenland. Why does it matter? Well, it's the same size that was coming out of Europe. You remember, there were 3.1s here last night. So 3.1 in Poland, 3.1 down here at Canaries, you can see it, and now a 3 all the way up here at the perimeter. Same-sized earthquake spreading out across the region. Whether it's 3s, 4s, 5s, 6s, happens a lot. Let's go over to Central and South America. Since my update last night, not too much to report to you further in Central America. The 4.4 at South Mexico's border with Guatemala, and Fuego Volcano is erupting here, as well as Popocatépetl erupting up in Mexico City. We skip over all of this down to the south, and we get into Reventador at the Ecuador-Colombia border, Sabancaya in South Peru, and Planchon Petoroa down here further to the south. Oh yeah, Poas Volcano in Costa Rica. Poas right here. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 volcanoes erupting on this side of the plate. Over on this side of the plate, a little bit different. We have Ebico erupting up here in the Kuril Islands. And we have Sakurajima erupting here in South Japan. And then the 7 that I, or no wait, 8. The 8 that I named down here. So that's really, we're taking us to 10 volcanoes, 9 to 10 volcanoes on this side of the plate, and 6 on this side of the plate. That's lopsided. Seismically speaking, we're lopsided too. There's more seismic activity on this side of the plate, and not as much on this side. That's going to change. No doubt about it, that's going to change. There's compensation that happens on both sides of the plate. You get big movement on one side of the plate, you look to the other side of the plate for compensation within days. In this case, West Pacific, big time movement. East Pacific, not big time movement. It means we're going to take a huge step up. We're going to go from 4s, most likely increase by a full magnitude, maybe even 2 magnitudes by the time this is all said and done. Next few days. Not that long. We don't have to wait that long. South America, here's last night's activity. Get last night's activity out of here. What do you see? 1 lone 3. Now keep in mind, the volcanoes are equidistantly spaced here, here, and here, where they're erupting. For my people down to the east by southeast, I do have people in the South Sandwich Islands. Look, over far to your east, next to our letter X on our transfer zone, 5.1 earthquake. Why does it matter? We have to go back several days. We can trace it back to the other 5.1 that struck up here to the north. So we got a 5.1 here, and we got a 5.1 here. We're still waiting to see what happens in 7 to 10 days from the point where this 6.3 happened. That takes us up to the 25th, which means we still have 6 days to go. Ultimately, this 5.1 down here came directly from here. But it's not that this 5.1 that struck up here caused this 5.1 down here. It's that both 5.1s, this one and this one, well, wait, you can't see it. This one and this one, both of them were caused by an energy or a force that traveled across the region, start and finish, like bookends. In between, well, we're waiting for new activity to develop in the next few days. Okay, continental United States. We'll go all the way up to Alaska's mainland, where we start out here on the plate boundary. We go past the inlet that goes into Anchorage, and then we go all the way up to the northern slopes, where the pumping operations are. Well, that's low compared to where we were. Look. Look what happened over the past few days. Okay, now that might not look like big activity, because it's not. It's not incorporating, you know, large megaquakes or anything. But just look at the spread of activity, how it went all the way across. Now there's a big open area right here. Well, guess what's right here? Vinaya Minas volcano that was erupting a few months ago. The middle point between our earthquakes on mainland and our earthquakes across the Aleutians, and make note of the magnitudes. Let's read it off for you. 4.4 on one end. Whoops. 4.4 on one end. 4.2 on the other. In between, 4.2, 4.4. 4.3, 4.4. 4.3, and 2 4s. In other words, the same sized earthquakes across a vast distance spread out equally, equal distance spaced, no less. Now I can turn off the rings, you should still be able to see the equal distance spacing on this. So how much energy do you think it would take to push all of the Kuril Islands, Kamchatka, and the Aleutians all the way over towards mainland Alaska, and then in the middle have a 50,000 foot high blast at Bezumiani Volcano 2 days ago? Yeah, so it's a fair amount of energy, and it's coming over towards Alaska. But then in Alaska today, hush hush, it's gone pretty much quiet. Threes? Yeah. Everything that we see where we see threes, I'm expecting fives. Down here where we see fours, I'm expecting upper fives. maybe even low-end sixes. Over here, where we have fours, I'm expecting fives and sixes as well in the next few days. I don't think we're going to get out of that. Now, let's go out to Hawaii out here. Guys, new activity, but I need to show you the microquakes. These are all the small earthquakes, mixed with the earthquakes that people might feel. But what's changed since last night? Well, I told you last night that there was no activity over at Kilauea, right? And that's true. There was no activity at Kilauea. Now, here, we have a new outbreak that started to take place at Kilauea directly. See it? The stack of earthquakes there. Also, Mauna Loa was hit, as well as Mauna Kea last night, and the earthquakes we talked about last night along the coast. So what's changed since last night? Kilauea and Mauna Loa. Let's show you where the earthquake is on Mauna Loa first, and then we'll jump over to Kilauea. Nothing has changed in my assessment from where we were last night, or yesterday, or the day before, or the day before, or the day before that. I stand by it. It's going to take months, not years, and eventually it will blow. It'll blow with something smaller than Mount St. Helens, but something bigger, much bigger than the 30,000-foot high blast that happened when it just got blocked for a day or two. You guys remember that. Okay, here's our earthquake. I'll notice anything. It's at the top or the caldera of Mauna Loa. Mauna Loa is the biggest shield volcano on the planet, I believe. Somebody else might be able to correct me on that, but I believe it's the biggest on the surface of the planet. And there's the earthquake right at the top. Last night, we were just to the north on the flanks of Mauna Kea. Mauna Kea is right here where our observatories are. We have the different observatories up here. It's not normally seismically prone very much. That's why they built the observatories there. Now here's Kilauea. Kilauea is where the new stack is, and it's now a rubble pit. It doesn't look anything like this. The crater is gone, the lava lake is gone, and three quarters of the caldera is gone. It's just, like I said, a giant rubble pit that collapsed. Well, down below it, a series of earthquakes have started to take place over the past several weeks and months, but in particular, this week, a 5.5 hit on the edge of this here, down here southeast of Kilauea. This is the Middle East Rift Zone, and it's refilling. As it's refilling, new earthquakes are breaking out, now a swarm up towards the top. Just something you have to watch. Professionals said this was all done. They said the eruption had stopped. That's going to be something that people come back in the future and really shake their heads on and be like, how could they have even said that? Yeah, and then people come back. Hopefully they'll find my videos. Somebody in the future will. And say, wow, at least there was some person that was talking about this. While they're all saying it's done, I'm telling you guys, it's going to blow at some point in the future. And I think months, not years. Okay, let's go into the mainland of the U.S. Let's start with the earthquakes here going in Texas. Hold on, let me get a sip of my coffee. So, you guys know we updated the aero map? Ha, take a look. Look at this. So, a 2.8 and a 2.7. Would you believe me if I told you both of these earthquakes? First of all, they're about the same size. The whitish-colored earthquake, we told everyone 2 days ago, 3 days ago, to watch next to Fort Stockton for something about this size, up to near 3. Now, why did I tell everybody to watch West Texas over near Fort Stockton, of all places? And why do we have an arrow that goes down through here? And why is the earthquake right on the arrow? Now, if you're not familiar with the arrows and what that shows, it's the North American Craton Edge. Now, this is just 24 hours worth of earthquakes, so this isn't a long period of time. This is, again, 24 hours. It's a perfect match. Going down through Texas, up through Missouri in the New Madrid seismic zone, then making a U-shaped bend down through Alabama, and then going up the East Coast all the way up through New England. Now, look at the quakes one more time, compared to the edge of the Craton. Now that you understand that, we're going to go pull the coordinates and show you what's in Texas. Why did I warn here? Well, this gets into California, actually. Activity builds and starts to swarm in Southern California. Then, within days, usually the pressure transfers out of California over to the east and strikes the nearest weak point on the edge, outside edge of the Craton. So why is there a weak point in Texas on the outside edge of the Craton? Let me show you. Do you see all these little square pads that are here? All the little square pads are different drill points. Oil and gas. There's the shadow of a jack right there. And it's just all over the place. Tanks, pumps, jacks, pipes, wells, so forth, all the way across. Texas is known for its pumping, but man, I don't think people understand how much we're doing out here now. We are the number one energy producer on the planet, but it comes at an earthquake cost. So every spot where they've, you see it, every spot where they've drilled, it's insane, right? You see how many there are. This right here, this is low. This is actually, here, let me show you where it's actually just insane, even more. Take a look. Whole counties like that. And it kind of fans out a little bit across this, like this county right here is not nearly as much as the one just to its north, which is the entire dang county. And that's just one county out of, you see, hopefully, you may have to full screen it to get an idea of. And for instance, here's the town. Here's a town where people live. And then look what's around it. Yeah, this is not a town. Unless the wells themselves have become intelligent and amassed into their own population centers. Let's go up to the east by northeast into Oklahoma, where we have the same thing going on that's down in Texas. Now, not nearly as many drill points yet, but give them enough time, they'll catch up. Up in Oklahoma, they have about 526,000 different drill points. And let's just see where our nearest one is here. Ah, right here. There's the shadow of the jack and pump. There's our tank pipelines and so forth. And I'm sure there's more nearby. Our imagery date is as of 2016, so there's probably a boatload more. They've opened this up for exploration in the past few years. Here's another one right here. All right, proving my case. Over to the east we go, and we get into the New Madrid seismic zone, and we get over into eastern Tennessee. These two earthquakes are on the deformed edge of the craton only, with no pumping operations there. Strictly what I would call natural earthquakes alone, with no preemptive cause, except for push coming across the edge of the craton. But over in Utah, it's an entirely different story. Just like what's going on in Texas, just like what's going on over in Oklahoma, this little stack of earthquakes here, over in Utah, where does it take us? Coordinates from the USGS, not up for debate. Here's the earthquake epicenter, imagery date as of 2015, and Farron, Utah, right next to it. Here, let me turn on our, so there it is, Farron, Utah, and you'll see all of these, or maybe you don't. Let me zoom in and show it to you a little bit better. You'll see the pads with the tanks, the pumps, the pipelines, the jacks. Again, another pumping operation. Now, it goes down around the outside, and I haven't fully marked them, and they may have more that have been done since this imagery date of 2016 into 2015. But all of them, I mean, come on, even the untrained eye should be able to start to pick this stuff out now. And we go up, and it really goes into a gangbusters operation spread out across the mountains. So down in Texas, it's open flatlands where they've done this. But it doesn't matter. Up here in the mountains, doing the same thing, and it goes up here past where it says oil field, or all of them are, and it goes up across the border, even. It doesn't stop. And keep going. Hey, look, Duchesne. D-U-C-H-E-S-N-E. Duchesne's? Very close, but no cigar. Oh, there's nothing at that pad. Here's one. There we are. You get the picture. So, pumping operation here. Pumping operation here. Pumping operation here. No pumping operations over to the east from last night. And last but not least, before we get over to the west coast, take a look one more time. Edge of the craton. Coming out of Yellowstone National Park, of all places. What's up here? Hoback, Wyoming. I showed it last night, but another earthquake struck since yesterday. Or is it the same quake? Either way, it's been in the last 24 hours. There's something here. something is here nearby. Yellowstone, of course. There's Yellowstone National Park, and next to it is Jackson Hole, Wyoming. South Park, Wyoming. Jackson Hole right there. But I want to draw your attention to all the pumping operations right through the valley here. You might start to see them if we zoom in close. You'll see we've got different brine ponds and pipelines and tanks and jacks. And then on this side, same thing. And it's just a little bit harder to see. At this elevation, it really is hard to see. So let me zoom in and show you. There we go. Now you'll start to see the tanks, the pumps, the jacks, the pipelines that connect between the spots. This is a wastewater disposal location. And they pump in chemical-laden wastewater to break apart the shale to get the gas and oil out. Goes all the way up through the valley here. This whole thing is basically fracked. Well, Yellowstone's magma chamber has now been found to be 11 Grand Canyons in size, starting inside the park here and going all the way up into Montana, around through Idaho, and coming back down across right through this area. 11 Grand Canyons total size, going down at an angle by many kilometers, starting up at the surface at the park here. Yeah, you find out a lot more as you do more measurements and do more studies. So they drilled into it. I don't think that was wise, but let's recap. Drill point up near Yellowstone, drill point down at Utah, drill point over in Texas, drill point up in Oklahoma. Notice anything about those? They all fall on the edge of the craton, where humans have drilled, apparently, over and over and over and over and over again, creating weak points, perforations on the plate. Let's go over to the West Coast, where we don't have any earthquakes since last night to be reported out of Washington. This one was from last night. Nothing in Oregon at all again today. And to top it all off, the slow slip supposedly just suddenly stopped. I don't buy it. I never do. I always think that they're doing something underhanded up here. But take a look at it. The slow slip that was going nonstop, it's now stopped in the Olympic Peninsula and changed locations. Down to Olympia, it shifted. Now, when it shifted, also down south at the Oregon, North California border region, I'll say it's more in Oregon, though, and up to the north, though, take a look. Big clusters of red dots. These are not earthquakes. Vibrations as the plate shifts. So an earthquake is an actual fracture in the plate. This is as the plate's moving. So you see where it's moving. 48 hours, moving up in Washington across the Olympic Peninsula. And again, a cluster at the Oregon-California border. Why does that matter? Well, there's no earthquakes being reported at all. Okay, as the plate's shifting, no earthquakes. Well, I guess that's going to be replaced with earthquakes, don't you think? And here's another problem, and I'm just going to say it again. No earthquakes reported out of Oregon, not even a 0.0. Maybe they'll get the memo today and finally report an earthquake. Eh, they'll report that obligatory explosion or something. Let's go on to California's coast, where we have a still ongoing swarm at Geysers, California, Clear Lake Volcano. So here are our coordinates. The name speaks for itself. It's a well-known volcano, but humans have drilled in to this volcano to get steam. And lo and behold, the spot where we drilled into the volcano to get steam has become a weak point that's getting hit over and over again by new swarms of earthquakes as the force is exerted on the overall plate. Imagine it like this. This spot up here is pushing down here, and as it pushes down here, it inundates the whole thing like a giant stone block with pressure across the whole block. And there's weak points in the block that have been drilled in some cases, or that Mother Nature has punched up through the crust with volcanoes. And both types of weak points, whether humans have drilled into it or whether Mother Nature has punched up through it, those weak points in the plate are sought out by the force as it inundates the whole block. Okay, that's why we have a swarm there. And it's picking up, which means something came in from off the coast. Somebody said to me, Dutch, what do you think about the earthquakes not being reported off the coast? Come on, there's obviously fours and fives that are striking out here most likely on a semi-weekly basis, and the professionals are hiding them. That's what they're doing. And then you see the consequences downstream, and you wonder where it came from. It comes from the area where Jack Squat, you know who, up here in the Northwest, Dingleberry, whoever, is not reporting the earthquakes. Sorry to name call him. Let's go down here across the Bay Area. Where on the creeping section, northern creeping section of the San Andreas, or the South Hayward Fault, a 2.2 to 2.3. But then, that cluster that I showed you last night, there's nothing to replace it today. Pumping operation here where the 1.6 is, pumping operation where the 1.5 is. Right next to the San Andreas, thousands of drill points through the valley. Do you need to see it? Do you need to see it? It started at Kolinga last night. You can watch it in my video last night if you really need to see it. But let's see, where's Kolinga? Starting here at the thousands of drill points, all oil and gas, and then going down here across to the east-southeast, going down to the south tip of the valley, right down here, next to Taft and Maricopa. And when we zoomed in last night, I showed it, but I'll show it again. More oil and gas pumping operations. Now, do you think it's wise to drill thousands of drill points going out miles on all directions right next to the most seismically prone area on the planet, or at least in the continental United States? This is the San Andreas, this giant diagonal line. Right next to it, again, it's not an exaggeration, right next to it. Starting down here, this looks like a mountain range, right? Well, they took this mountain range and did this. Scraped out all the tops of the mountains and put 10 pumps per mountaintop here. The entire mountain range. That's just this. That doesn't count everything down here and everything up to the west-northwest, which is also dry. And come on. How could somebody not realize that if you do this amount of drilling, going out in all directions, thousands of points, that it's going to act like a break in concrete, that it's going to attract that pressure that's coming out of the fault, exerted into the stone or into the giant slab of the plate? How could they not realize that? This is fundamental physics here. It's like a bunch of kids were involved with drilling, or they knew, in which case that turns everything on its head and invalidates all the stuff that the professionals have tried to say about me and all kinds of stuff. So which is it? Did they know? Or were they just complete rejects and not, I almost said the other R word. Yeah, you gotta watch what I'm saying, man. I get a little angry. These people are just foolish. Up to the east by northeast in northeast California. These earthquakes right at the border, and these earthquakes just to the west of the border, north of Lake Tahoe. This brings us right in the middle of what I've been calling, and I stand by this, some kind of ancient supervolcano. It's not marked as a supervolcano. Nobody's noticed it. As far as I know, I went and looked everywhere. I couldn't find any talk about it. Nobody making any videos on it, that's for sure, and certainly nobody pointed it out as a spot that keeps getting hit with earthquakes. Look, here's the earthquake epicenter. Here's our giant oval shape again. How many times do I need to show it? We're getting earthquakes striking in a ring around this thing. On the northern side is a geothermal field. These are the needles and these are fumaroles. And on the southern side, same distance from this oval, same distance to the south, is Steamboat Springs. Another geothermal location where humans have drilled in to get steam at these turbines. So the giant oval shape, supervolcano from a long time ago, keeps getting hit. Same with down to the south here, only this is not as long ago. This spot here where the 2.7 is, most certainly right inside of a supervolcano. It's called Long Valley Caldera. 1,000 cubic kilometers of melt down below, 240 cubic miles. Just elevated to supervolcanic status 6 months ago, as they found with earth-penetrating tomography the 1,000 cubic kilometers of melt down below here. So 6 months ago, they find out this thing's a supervolcano. They got a ski resort built on the side of it, on the side of Mammoth Mountain, which is a smaller volcano, which in itself is huge, but it lines the outside of this oval shape. So this oval shape is like this one, only the one up to the north is bigger. This would be a bigger supervolcano than this one. Regardless, look what humans did on the inside of the supervolcanic caldera. Ah, some genius rocket scientist who didn't understand that pressure transfers across regions thought it'd be a great idea to drill into the center of this supervolcano to get steam to provide power for Mammoth Lakes instead of just building a little dam and using the water there. Wonderful stuff. Let's go across the border. What's over here? This should take us to the edge of the Ring of Laccoliths. A laccolith is a bulge in the plate that happens when magma comes in a layer down below the plate and causes a bulge but it doesn't erupt. Copy these coordinates and put them in. It should take us in just a couple miles to the east, what we were just looking at, actually. There we go. See where it brings us in right here? Boom! And it brings us in next to Unnamed and Coaldale Volcanic Butte. Let's go down to Coaldale. No coal there, but really, like I said, Ring of Laccoliths. That's this right here. So you see it, ring shape, and each one of these, some of them have ruptured in the past. Apparently pressure came in that was great enough that ruptured this out onto the surface. And it's happened before with different types of lava flows. Glass flows, some black, some more a reddish color, and then bulges where there have not been any eruptions yet. But it's bulging with a basin in the middle. Now look at the size of this and compare it to the supervolcano or Mono Lake next to it. All three are about the same size. All right. Do I need to show you every single earthquake? I don't think I do. Let's go down here and look at this stack. This should bring us into Kozo Junction, Little Lake. Little Lake. Now, Little Lake is the town we're triangulated from. When I zoom in, you might see a little body of water here. That's not Little Lake. These little bodies of water that we'll zoom in right next to. Where are they? Here. See? Another geothermal pumping operation going to turbines to turn via steam from this volcanic field called Kozo Volcanic Field. Okay, earthquake coming in right next to Volcano Peak or just west by southwest of Volcano Butte. Here's Volcano Butte. You can still see the cinder or spatter cone that's on the side of there. And then over to the west is the more eruptive point where there's been at least 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 different eruptions right here in the past at Volcano Peak. Let's go over at the Nevada-California border. This should bring us in next northeast of Yubihibi Craters. Yubihibi. Yubihibi Craters. Get a sip of my coffee. I sailed, boy. I'm going out to Yubihibi Craters. Go check it out, see what's going on out there. Why are we... Well, how do I even know about Yubihibi? How do I know the name before I even looked it up? This goes back. There's been a series of earthquakes that keep striking here. So right next to Yubihibi Craters, which are a series of cinder cones and spatter cones and... Look at this. Look at this point that erupted at some point in the past. Look at this crater. Right here. Look at that. Alright, so that blasted out, but the actual field is about 50 square kilometers right around here. Now the earthquake striking on the north side of it, look what's right next to it. We have a series of other old volcanic buttes that are here that are just, they're not even named. Don't even have any information on them, but there's no doubt about it. Just, maybe Google Earth doesn't have the naming on them. Maybe that's what it is. I mean, I'm not saying there's no name to it. It's just not marked. We don't have any information. And clearly, it's an old volcanic field. Look at the tuftage. Look at the black basalt up on the surface. Black and red. Igneous rock and so forth. So let's recap really quick. Geysers, California up here where the big stack is. Over to these earthquakes that goes around the big oval shape north of Steamboat Springs and the earthquake next to Steamboat Springs. Itself, which again is a volcano. Down here, the Laccolith, and then going down here to the border, going across to Mammoth Mountain, Long Valley Supervolcano. This, Kozo Junction, Little Lake, California, again another geothermal pumping operation and volcano. Here, Yubihibi Craters. No pumping operation there, as far as I can tell. Now, there might be. There could be some kind of geothermal operation right next to this, and I just haven't caught it yet. Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if there was. Looks like somebody's done some mining out here, probably some gold out there in the hills, but again, I don't see anything marked. Doesn't mean it's not there. If anybody knows about any geothermal that's here, any kind of drilling that humans have done, please let me know. It's Death Valley, basically, in the spot. Over here, these three distinct sets of quakes, nuclear test site. Nuke test site, but they're not doing nuke tests there now. This is just pressure releasing at breakpoints in the plate. Humans created this. So, what did they create? Fractures in the plate due to underground nuke testing. Here, here, and here. So let's go turn on our nuke test information. And we'll start where the earthquake is. And here we go. The earthquake is right here, and this is at U.S. Nuke Buggy A, Buggy B, Buggy C. Let's look up Buggy B. U.S. Nuke Operation Buggy B-SS, March 12, 1968, just 1 kiloton. Here's Buggy C-SS. U.S. Nuke Buggy C-SS, March 12, 1968, 1.08. And Buggy A, also 1.08, March 12, 1968. So, nuke test site, right at it, down below it, inside of it, fractures in the plate. And as force comes across the plate, giant slab of stone, and we've got a break in it. We put a break in it from a series of hundreds of underground nuke tests. Look at all of them right here. This is not an aerial bombardment range. These are all underground nuke test sites. Every single one. U.S. Nuke Operation Rudder, 150 kilotons, December 28, 1976. Weak points sought out by Mother Nature. All right, what else do we need to look at? This 1.2 and 0.6 out in the Mojave Desert, those are quarry blasts. And we get down here. I looked this one up last night in last night's video. That's next to the pumping operation in South San Joaquin Valley. The 0.9, well, this is replacing what hit last night with a new earthquake. So last night in southeast LA, and then going over to the east. This stack of quakes has dropped off. Take a look at it. What is it? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. 14 little microquakes, that's it? We had big stacks here. Where did it go? Went over to Texas. Just as expected. Southern California, when we start to swarm, within a few days, we look over to Texas. If Texas does not get hit, then we really look to Southern California for the potential of something in a 4 or 5 or 6 range, depending on how long it takes. But if it doesn't transfer out to Texas, the pressure builds here, gets stuck here. We only see that happen a few times. Normally, it transfers over to the east. That's good news for the people in California. You watch this. Watch for this to start to swarm. Then watch Texas. Soon as Texas gets hit, you'll see your swarm go down, like pressure's been relieved over to another spot. But, look what's coming your way from the north, north by northwest. The plate shifting up here in Washington. No doubt about it, all those tremors happening across Washington. There's gotta be some activity that struck out here off the coast. Professionals are hiding to save their asses. Pardon my language. To save their posteriors. Posterior maximus, instead of cranius maximus. They gotta save their posterior maximus. Maximus posterius? I didn't take Latin. I'm just guessing. Let's go over and take one final look across the West Pacific and just sum this up real quick. With, I'm watching for the potential of large earthquakes for the rest of the day. Over here in the West Pacific, in particular in between our sets of quakes, we have one more day to go in the 10-day watch for up to a 7.2 over here in the West Pacific based upon our deep 6-point-something that happened over here next to Fiji. That was all last week. 7 to 10-day watch expires pretty much tonight into tomorrow. Now, same time all that's going on, we have our deep 6.2 over in South America where we still have pretty much 5 to 6 days left to go in this warning. So, be ready, have a plan. Don't let your guard down, for certain, and with the number of volcanic eruptions, please listen. West Pacific, Indonesia, Japan, Philippines, Taiwan, Papua New Guinea. Look, 10 different eruptions in the course of a day. Pretty much. 9. And multiple deep earthquakes, spreads of 4s and 5s, and you're going up in magnitudes. You're actually starting to go back up out of 4s, going into 5s. I think it's going to take a full step up. Everywhere where you see 4s, we're going to see clusters of 5s. Everywhere where we see 5s, we have the potential to go even higher. So the good news is, the last 36 hours, we only have a few spots where we have 5s that could go higher into larger activity. I'm waiting, from Indonesia especially, and you should too. Anything else? Has anything else struck since I've done my update beginning here? Ah, South Spain has been hit by a new 2.0 at the Straits of Gibraltar. I don't see anything else, though. So, now is a good time for me to remind you. You need to have an earthquake plan and at least think about what you're going to do if an earthquake strikes. Taking shelter underneath a table or desk is probably going to be your best idea. If you're not confident in your structure, like the building you're in, if it's made out of stone, for instance, brick or stone stack of any kind, well, you're probably going to need an exit plan just in case. So first thing, you'll take shelter. If it's just, you know, a little bit of shaking, things could fall. But if it's a large earthquake, you bypass just taking shelter underneath the table or desk if you're in a stone structure and you just head straight to the door. But you got to pick which door you're going to go out. Right? And if you're going to go outside, you might not be coming back in for a while. So you may want to have an emergency kit that you grab. Seasonal specific, whether it's hot outside in the summer or if it's freezing cold in the winter, you have a seasonal specific bag that addresses your basic needs for the first day or two. Just the first day or two. This is something that's going to go into a backpack that you can carry. I'm not talking about canned goods and big old jugs of water. You can't carry that stuff. So you need to have an appropriate plan for the first day or two that covers a little bit of food, a little bit of water, change of clothes, set of shoes, car keys, ID, debit card, medication if you require it, flashlight and battery, emergency radio. You know, you know the drill. You're just supposed to put it into a bag and have it ready to go. I'm just reminding you again today, again. All right. So have a plan. Be ready. And you'll be way better off than all those other people who refuse to even listen to reason and develop a plan just to save themselves. You know, they're like, oh, I'll just wait for somebody else to, I'll wait for a big brother to come get me. Good luck with that. You get me put onto a bus, a school bus with special installed bars on the windows as they bring you to a guarded gymnasium and pack you in with a bunch of people you don't know who are coughing, crying, and everything else. Yeah, I think I'll pass on that. I'm going to be a little bit more self-sufficient. I'm going to be out of here before FEMA even arrives. I'll be at my campsite in the middle of the woods communicating with laser light or something. All right. What else do we have going on? Let's go over to my YouTube page. Hello, YouTube. Hello, everybody on YouTube. Where are we? We're at 300,268. I broke 300,000 subscribers. Please subscribe to my channel. I'm still trying to grow it. Share it. That's key. Tell people that I try to do this on a semi-daily basis. I take it very seriously when I talk about spots that I'm warning, and I just like to do updates as well. So even if I'm not warning an area, you can let people know. I'll get on and do updates, tell you where events are striking, and that's the best I can do for you. It's more than the USGS does. All they do is give you a coordinate. They don't even tell you what's at the location. So I'm doing my best, and I hope you like it. You guys also over on Twitch, let's go say hi. Hello over on Twitch. Everybody on there, how many people are in here? 250? Oh man, what's going on? It must be nice outside. Everybody's going out to have a nice time outside. Yeah, don't have time for earthquakes. That's okay. Again, you guys are epic. Thank you so much for sharing the information and getting it out there. We're keeping this going nonstop. What else? That's it? Good. Time for you guys to go have a good day. Me to keep watch on earthquakes throughout the day. And if anything else goes down, I'll be back on. I'm going to save this as a video, and then we'll share it out over on YouTube to top it all off so you guys can get it out to the world. Just again, a quick update to show you what's going on around the planet. And if anything big hits, I'll be back on to let you know. See you later. Peace out.